Hi, I'm John Taylor Gatto, and this is What You've Been Missing.
Nothing in the world can take the place of persistence. Talent will not. Nothing is more common than unsuccessful men with talent. Genius will not. Unrewarded genius is almost a proverb. Education will not. The world is full of educated derelicts. Persistence and determination alone are omnipotent. The slogan, "Press on," has solved and always will solve the problems of the human race. Calvin Coolidge, 1933. Greetings and welcome. I'm your host and navigator, Richard Grove, and this is a very special interview episode of What You've Been Missing, featuring the gentle tone, scholarly insights, and wealth of wisdom that combines in the form of John Taylor Gatto, the legendary educator, author, and icon of liberty who offers a lifetime of perspectives on the origins, intentions, and destiny of the compulsory public school system. This five-hour journey represents a landmark in American history and was filmed over 2 days on July 4th weekend, 2011, in the Constitution State of Connecticut. This is a comprehensive interview session which not only memorializes John's life's work, but also embodies a return of our birthright as human beings. Truly an event which is relevant and relative to each and every one of us. This message applies to children and adults, parents and grandparents, students and teachers, administrators and politicians, blue collar, white collar, no collar. Everyone who uses words and symbols to meet their needs, everyone who depends on accurate information to thrive and survive in this world. The purpose of this interview with John is to provide each and every individual with the essential facts which pertain to our survival here on Earth, both as individuals and as a species, and yet have been censored from our public schooling. The envisioned outcome would be for each and every human being to possess the knowledge and understanding which allows them to exercise intellectual self-defense and self-liberty, thereby succeeding in pursuing and attaining happiness. It's designed to be shared and studied by individuals and groups to provide the evidence, organize the ideas, and facilitate the constructive conversations and actions necessary to address the root causes of our ever-growing incoherence as human beings. Since this interview contains over 200 footnotes and references and discusses the contents of more than 30 classic books essential to understanding life here on Earth, I would humbly recommend that your first viewing be invested into just soaking in this information and consider it for yourself, and after thinking about it, to then view it again with the intent of looking up the references to embolden your understanding and clarify the focus of your new expanded perspectives. This interview session could be screened over 5 hours, 5 months, or 5 years, as it could take that long to consume the primary and secondary source materials referred to herein. Most importantly, what you get out of the ultimate history lesson will be in direct proportion to the amount of attention and focus that you can invest into it. As each hour of the interview progresses into another, you are literally crossing thresholds of discovery. And by hour 5, the layers of these discoveries yield a truly inspiring realization. That being said, the conversation which forms the entirety of this interview is almost entirely composed of facts and references pointing toward a preponderance of evidence, which is, for the most part, unknown to the general public. And it has everything to do with the myriad of crises which face humanity, starting with our own incoherence and inability to problem solve our way forward. We're not asking you to agree with us nor to believe what we're saying. We're simply trying to provoke you into looking into these matters for yourself by providing you with an accurate map which leads to your own factual and substantial understanding of reality. For as Aristotle once wrote, it is the mark of an educated mind to be able to entertain a thought without accepting it. Through these interview sessions with John, you're going to be introduced to a variety of historical personalities, and we hope, curious to review the history which has led us to this point. And to that end, this is not about disproving or debunking what we've been taught so much as it is a journey of discovery to discern reality and to discover our birthright as human beings, so that we might go forward in order to meet the challenges we all face here on this planet together. This is truly something that corporate establishment media, public schools, and universities cannot afford to teach us. So without further ado, let us begin, as they say, at the beginning. On December 15th, 1935, John Taylor Gatto was born in western Pennsylvania in the coal mining and steel milling town of Monongahela, about 35 miles southeast of Pittsburgh. During his early school years, he spent a year at an elite Jesuit boarding school near Latrobe, Pennsylvania, where, as you'll soon hear, he learned to think dialectically and was beaten sufficiently by the nuns to create his outspoken temperament, which has endured lifelong. John did undergraduate work at Cornell University, the University of Pittsburgh, and Columbia University, and then served in the United States Army Medical Corps at Fort Knox, Kentucky, and Fort Sam Houston, Texas. Following Army service, John did graduate work at the City University of New York, Hunter College, Yeshiva University, the University of California, Cornell, and Reed College, which is a private independent liberal arts college located in Oregon. Like many famous American iconoclasts, John first honed his skills in a variety of professions before finding his talent for teaching, which proves to be his real gift to this world. After almost 30 years of teaching in New York City's inner city schools, he was named New York City Teacher of the Year in 1989, 1990, and 1991, and that same year was also named New York State Teacher of the Year. Later in 1991, he wrote a letter announcing his retirement from teaching titled, "I Quit, I Think," to the op-ed pages of the Wall Street Journal, stating that he no longer wished to, quote, "hurt kids to make a living," end quote. Soon thereafter, he was the subject of a show at Carnegie Hall titled An Evening with John Taylor Gatto, which then launched a career of public speaking in the area of public school reform. He then began a worldwide public speaking and writing career and has received several awards from libertarian organizations, including the Alexis de Tocqueville Award for Excellence in the Advancement of Educational Freedom in 1997. John has been invited to speak all around the world to share his research and has spoken to audiences in Australia, Spain, France, England, Mexico, China, and Canada, as well as every one of the 50 American states. Since his public resignation in 1991, he has traveled over 3 million air miles, spoken at Harvard University, NASA Space Center, the White House, Smith College, Cato Institute, and many other places. He's also been a keynote speaker at over 30 state homeschool conventions, and he supports something called unschooling and open source education for personal learning. In his book, Weapons of Mass Instruction, here's how John defines open source education. Open source learning accepts that everything under the sun might be a possible starting point on the road to self-mastery and a good life. In open source, learning sequences are personally designed or personally signed off on, and everyone you encounter in life is a potential teacher. In open source, teaching is a function, not a profession. Everyone learns and everyone can teach themselves how to learn anything, as well as learning how to teach others. In open source, students are the active initiators. You learn that you either write your own script in life, or by default, without your input, you become an unwitting actor in someone else's script. The main thesis of John's body of work can best be illustrated, in my opinion, by asking the question, what do public schools actually teach children? And answering it with the main themes contained in John's first book, printed in 1992, titled Dumbing Us Down. He makes the following observations about how public schools are designed in form and function. Public schooling teaches confusion by breaking coherence. It presents an ensemble of information that the child needs to memorize in order to stay in school. Public schooling teaches them to accept their class affiliation. Public schooling makes them indifferent and suppresses natural curiosity. Public schooling makes them emotionally dependent on approval from authority. Public schooling also makes them intellectually dependent on experts and authorities to think on their behalf. Public schooling teaches them a kind of self-confidence that requires constant confirmation by experts and authorities, also known as provisional self-esteem. Public schooling makes it clear to them that they cannot hide, that they are always supervised, under surveillance, especially in today's society where everything online is tracked, information is sold in a variety of ways to a variety of predators. Bibliography. John's poetic prose and diligent documentation can be studied in his prodigious preponderance of publications, including Dumbing Us Down, The Hidden Curriculum of Compulsory Schooling, 1992, The Exhausted School, 1993, A Different Kind of Teacher, Solving the Crisis of American Schooling, 2000, The Underground History of American Education, 2001, and in my opinion, this is an essential book to read as it stimulates your internal dialogue and draws questions as to why are children being methodically undermined, while simultaneously providing you with the answers and comprehensive references. John also published an article called Against School, published by Harper's Magazine in 2003, and last but not least, Weapons of Mass Instruction, A Schoolteacher's Journey Through the Dark World of Compulsory Schooling, 2008. John's website is johntaylorgatto.com, and you can help him fund his current projects, sample the underground history of American education, and browse his bookstore. We've also created a special website to support your further study of this project, theultimatehistorylesson.com, which acts as a single point of access to all the media, references, notes, and source materials and bonus features associated with this interview set. Realizing that releasing this information is not enough, we've invested a great deal of effort into organizing and providing you with a research library and all the tools, methods, and resources that you'll need to learn your way forward following this interview. Possibly one of the most useful tools is our use of the Personal Brain software to enter, organize, and connect all of this information into a comprehensive big picture, literally helping you to connect all of the dots of useful information and formulate a useful understanding. We use the brain internally to help us organize the plethora of prolific facts, artifacts, and personalities that we've encountered while attempting to understand the nature of public education. In addition to hosting the brain models, theultimatehistorylesson.com also hosts the video files for this interview set, as well as the audio-only versions of this interview in MP3 and CD format so that you can listen to it on the go. This site also hosts the footnotes, links, references, and PDF versions of the classic books discussed, and in the near future, we'll be adding subtitles and translation into multiple languages and much more. TheUltimateHistoryLesson.com links you to our educational media producing partners, as well as the Tragedy and Hope online community, wherein you can leverage the research, methods, and tools in an international online community designed to be a fear-free zone of mutual respect wherein individual explorations are shared to empower everyone with a comprehensive understanding. The Tragedy and Hope online community is free to those who need it and sponsored by the individuals who can afford to support our educational projects. And since this project was funded by more than 50 individuals in the Tragedy and Hope online community, I would especially like to thank those of you who gave us the ability to invite John and produce the Ultimate History Lesson so that this empowering information can be understood worldwide. We also produced the Peace Revolution podcast, a virtual classroom for adults designed to point out and provide useful perspectives, resources, and organized information. Each episode contains a subject of study essential to understanding a comprehensive view of reality, all of which is focused on providing you with the history, contextual information and references, and the various methods and tools so that you can learn for yourself that which public schools cannot afford to provide. Specifically, we've produced episodes 41 through 45 of the Peace Revolution podcast, which feature all 5 hours of this interview coupled with historical analysis and commentary, which we provide to help you really understand what's being said. These episodes amount to another 15 hours of educational content, which is also available on theultimatehistorylesson.com, providing you with the metaphorical handles, if you will, so that you can grasp this material and use it to your own advantage in everyday life. Unlike any other interview you've ever witnessed, the conclusion of the Ultimate History Lesson is actually the starting point on your own personal journey of discovery. Due to the fact that we're trying to do something that hasn't yet been done, I've edited each hour of this interview such that from the crack of the slate until the end of the tape, you're witnessing John in a natural and forthright representation of his presence, and nothing he states in the coming hours has been taken out of order, out of context, or otherwise adjusted for theatrical purposes, as I feel that it would not be to anyone's benefit to change the flow of energy as it happened. These interview sessions are designed to resurrect your curiosity, stimulate your use of reason, inspire you to look around, provoke you into asking questions, sparking your creativity and your inventiveness, igniting the solution-making process in each and every one of us. Its function is to provide you with a ramp to learning, discussion, respectful debate, and compassionate forms of communication, as well as constructive action. Here's hour one of our interview with John Taylor Gatto. It's time to begin the Ultimate History Lesson. Thank you for tuning in and not dropping out.
You know, for pushing that button, you get a camera credit. That's pretty good.
That's right.
Awesome. I don't even know that we'll need the slides necessarily. I mean, we can start by talking about that.
Father, Son, Holy Ghost.
Grammar, logic, and rhetoric. So grammar is the Son, logic is the Father, the Holy Ghost is rhetoric, and God is the consciousness. And so the Christian trivium came from the Greek trivium, but they used a metaphor to encode it. Now my question to you is a metaphor a lie, or is a metaphor something else?
I think we better start a little less abstract. One of the things, a fatigued old brain. I arrive at abstraction by arguing with myself through writing. So everything I write goes through about 20 drafts. And since I handwrite it, it's quite painful to read. And throw it out. But I don't really know what I say, what I'm going to say, or what I believe until I actually argue with what I think I believe. So,
what do you think you believe about schooling?
I think I believe that the metaphor schooling clearly tells you what it's expected to deliver. We only use the expression one other way commonly, and that's with the school of fish. And they are wonderful to watch. When one fin moves, all of them move. Thousands of fins move, and they're instantly receptive to what the group wishes. I don't know who gives the original signal, but education's diametrically opposite to that. I think it starts with the assumption that we get from a fingerprint or from DNA that no two people are alike, and that the ultimate realization of yourself is to find that uniqueness where your apparent physical resemblance to everybody else sort of dissolves as an illusion, and you stand absolutely alone, or you can select when you want to be part of the larger group. It seems clear to me that the business of schooling has done what Orwell clearly saw you do, or what Walter Lippmann said you do back in the 1920s. you steal the key language of the person you or the group you want to overthrow, and you redefine it, and people then become confused. It's Newspeak in 1984. So the schooling transformation occurs when they see that the language of education is highly regarded, highly respected, and even in people who don't participate, there's an urge in that direction. So you simply take the concepts and you claim that that's why people are being ritualized.
So you describe that individual beings, when in groups, kind of subvert their own individual thinking power. And the law of identity, none of us can change who we are. We have to be ourselves, and that is constant throughout life. So it's about figuring out how to remain individually self-reliant and self-sufficient as going through these systems that are trying to change us and to make us less self-reliant and more.
Very much so. And I think the awareness of these contrary dynamics is what gives rise to the theories of dialectic. I mean, Aristotle all the way through history, the variety of them, but they participate in the same way, is essentially asking you for your own self-defense, not to assume that what anyone says, especially as they climb the authority ladder, is the truth. Often the misinformation comes from innocent self-delusion. But just as often as you move up the power pyramid, it comes from a malign intent toward your own individuality.
So it's like a betrayal of truth that occurs, or, you know, a betrayal of you know, belief in some authority structure that you want to believe in is true, and then little by little you realize that it's not necessarily how it might have been presented to you?
Right. Even in your own individual inner life and consciousness, before the cameras rolled, I said, the way I learn what I'm thinking is to write something down that I think I believe, and then I argue with it, and it never survives. How about that? Now, what scares me is that when I go back to it year after year, most of it doesn't survive. I mean, it takes years before I get to a core and I say, I'm not personally capable of moving beyond this thing, so that we're so well conditioned from infancy, not to see the truth or relate the truth, but to shave it, that the first step in reaching for an education, I think, is to mistrust what you most are certain of, to mistrust that. Now, it may survive, but it needs tested not once, until you're exhausted from testing it.
Is the school system designed to get kids to grow into a thriving, self-responsible, self-reliant adult? Or is it to whittle away curiosity and to kind of stop them from thinking for themselves?
It's certainly not the former in any way, for the simple reason that throughout history, management doesn't know how to manage independent units, even partially independent units. Why shouldn't we ask, and any school people watching your film should begin immediately to ask politely, why are we doing this? It's a question you never hear, because it's heresy. I mean, the beleaguered classroom teacher doesn't know why he or she's doing that. They're told to do it. Maybe they can give it 5% personal spin. That's why they're doing it. Does it make sense for this particular life that's asking you the question? You don't know, and if you started to care, the logic of schooling would dissolve. No one is able. You can answer the question for yourself. I used to say to my classes, and over the course of 30 years teaching, I taught kids from the Gold Coast to the Upper West Side of Manhattan, and I taught kids from the center of Harlem and Spanish Harlem. And I would say to all of them, you have a right at any time, you gotta be polite though, because I'm just human, to say, why are we doing this? And if I can't produce an answer that convinces you that I believe it, then you have a right to opt out and do something else as long as you don't run wild and bring the whole house down. It helped me grow year after year. Not that they ask very often because they're conditioned not to do that, but enough did ask that I was put on my own mettle to say, why am I doing this? And it was a continual expansion of my own insight until politically I couldn't do it any longer. The school, oddly enough, made me so internally famous that it drew extra attention. And my system couldn't survive under the scrutiny because they would see the disparity between what I was doing and what the protocols were. So there.
So it sounds like if I'm trying to get to the root cause of why your teaching career ended, it sounds like you started asking questions, John, and it sounded like the question started with why, with a question mark, and then maybe you were asking some other, like, you know, the five W's plus how, and you were actually getting observed knowledge.
Asking myself questions, right. Then forcing my classes to ask me questions and themselves questions, and eventually the productive output of my classes was so great, inadvertently, I didn't care how the school measured product, but it was so great that I would get visiting delegations, sometimes on a daily basis, for months, and they would leave baffled because they wouldn't see the drama unfolding that they understood as schooling, and they were right. It was less and less schooling, and eventually the pressure became impossible since I set out at the beginning of the year with an inner intention, if I had 120 kids, to have 120 individually written curricula. I never succeeded totally, but I got close enough that when the principal would drop by and only find 9 people in class and say, where are the rest, that I ran out of strategies to explain where the rest were. So, I couldn't operate. I couldn't function any longer because my physical strength wasn't up to it. So,
how did part of the strength of your actual teaching come from releasing children from the classroom and letting them go out in the world and actually gain some useful experience?
Huge amounts of it came from releasing anyone who had an independent course to follow, becoming that boy or girl's assistant, always with the mother's permission because they couldn't deal with that kind of additional political pressure. So what they would learn and bring back would be like food for me. I would be like I was 120 people simultaneously. Oh, I learned much more than I learned at the 2 Ivy League colleges I attended. I used to say to my wife, and it sounds fanciful, as though, oh, he must love children, which is not true. I love people. And people can be 5 years old, but people who suck their thumb and rattle and extend childhood, school's intention is to artificially extend childhood. And there really is no practical terminus for that. If they can extend it through graduate school and postgraduate.
What is the actual reason that their childhoods are being extended? How's it serve the
society? I think what we never discuss, or that the extreme left has preempted to discuss, so they marginalize themselves, is the intimate interrelationship between the economy and the way we train the young. To the extent that we once had a wildly variegated economy, I'm quoting Abraham Lincoln in 1859, famous speech of the Wisconsin Agricultural Association. Lincoln said, I call this mudsill theory because he used that term. Lincoln said the British are financing the whole Western movement, and they're attempting to reinstall their class system. And so they send their young sons over to make sure that not a whole lot of attention is paid to ordinary people or people who live in simple homes that have mud sills. He said they're not, according to the British thinking, they're not worth training or worrying about because there's no way they can possibly improve. Lincoln said, look around you. 3/4 of our population has an independent livelihood, and the quarter who doesn't works to put a little stake together to set up on their own and write their own script in life. He said, as a consequence, we don't have proletariat as they do in Britain and Germany and the European nations, and we aren't able to have a factory system. Where it exists in this country, which is in New England, in the textile industries, a factory will have 30 or 40 employees. They'll usually be young women waiting marriage. They'll be served tea at their machines, and there'll be opera performances staged for just to keep them at the machine, because these independent livelihoods lead to, you know, totally private, independent systems of value. So the British are wrong, but of course, the Civil War changed that. We're sold that it was a great crusade against slavery by the school system. The major historians who've turned their attention to that say, I mean, to a person, that slavery was already dead. It was staggering through its last couple of generations, not because of a moral transformation on the part of plantation owners, but because the wives of the plantation owners were scratching their head and saying, you know, the boss, my husband vanishes for a couple of days. We have all these new slaves and they're not black anymore. They're various shades of brown. So I'm thinking right now, I think Vern Parrington, but a number of historians 50 years ago said slavery was on its last legs because the Southern womanhood wouldn't stand for it any longer. Russia, I believe, had freed the serfs. Britain and the continent had done this thing. We were going to do it too. But it gave a nobility to the necessity to get rid of the Southern politicians who were trained in dialectical thinking, in rhetoric, and could run circles around the northern politicians in Congress. They could produce the most compelling arguments for this or that. And so the South had to be gotten rid of.
From my understanding, those dry goods like cotton from the South that were produced by slaves were then going to factories in the North. And the factory owners in the North figured out that the slave owners were paying too much overhead. It cost a lot to keep a whole family fed, etc. And there were letters exchanged, and they actually discovered it was cheaper. Why not make everyone a slave who doesn't know that they're a slave?
A wage slave.
Right.
And think only about the welfare idea. If you have a plantation family and you require harmony, even though some people are very subordinate, if somebody gets sick or too old to work, you can't, in fact, do the Simon Legree bit and get rid of them. Or what happens is morale collapses. So you have to care for them. The discussions on the highest level among northern industrialists was, why should we have to support Deadwood here? And we could do that if they were wage slaves. Yeah, yeah. And furthermore, people like Count Tolstoy was well aware of the hard core underneath the romantic arguments, and so were a number of other people. But the public dependent upon media and pulpits, which were subsidized by the owners, couldn't find a zone where they could think clearly, or someone would say, yeah, here's the truth, think about it.
Early forms of mass media propaganda from the pulpit or the newspaper.
Or the Chautauquas. Right. Oh, absolutely. The Chautauquas were put together by intense. The family that began Harper's Publishers and had the very prestigious journal of the time, Harper's Weekly.
Louis Lapham, the Lapham family.
Well, Lapham's a very latter day.
His grandfather was in charge of Harper's, though, and he was mayor of San Francisco, I believe.
Mayor, he was when the UN came in, and he told me that his boyhood was filled with foreign dignitaries in the home. His house guests were throwing back a glass of wine. So you can actually trace the small number of families behind the Chautauquas, which were the most compelling mass media of the day. And you'd hear about what was going on in Boston, out in Cincinnati, and you'd want that. And selectively, ideas and ways of thinking were introduced to the best people, and they used their local prestige to make sure that, you know, it's a natural process. So what we got was a second American Revolution between, 1865 and about 1910. This time the British won again, but they didn't win by force of arms, but by force of insight into the way opinion is created. And when the skilled workers who had intense pride and really were the key to the prosperity of early industrial operation, commercial operation, when the skilled workers understood their power, then industry and commerce were mechanized intensely, and you wiped out the need for skill. You took less quality, but now you had less contention, less argument. Carnegie was instrumental in eliminating the influence of skilled labor, and it continued right through the 20th century.
What influence have the Rockefellers had on organized labor, skilled labor, education?
The Rockefeller family can actually be traced way back in Dutch history. There's an ancestor of the Rockefellers who set up a rather detailed plan for global government hundreds and hundreds of years ago. And that is one of these flow charts that showed how you were going to do that or not. But or the great irony, of course, is that Rockefeller and Carnegie's families were fringe people in the United States, but using their brilliant insight into leverage and how it works, both were able to take nothing and pyramid it into quite a bit. Rockefeller actually, his father, I believe, but it may have been his grandfather, fled a rape charge, sort of like Strauss-Kahn's, up in Bainbridge, New York. He had been charged with rape of a maid and fled. They threw their, Rockefeller threw their weight behind, this is emblematic of how they were, behind Horatio Alger, who also had been charged with rape up here in Connecticut, and the Newsboys Lodging House. And if you read a wonderful book that exists, a limited edition, but it's kept continuously in print, called The Rise of the Dangerous Classes in New York City by the creator of American Adoption. When I started to research school, I kept running into the same people who put the adoption institution together and the school institution, one much more important than the other, but still the same names float in and out of one another. Charles Loring Brace, who I believe his father was the publisher of the Hartford Courant, I'm almost sure, in his early diaries say, I must find a way to become nationally famous. I mean, in Yale he wrote that he didn't have any idea how he's going to do that, but finally, it occurred to him that with these masses of immigrants being brought in to break the Irish labor monopoly in the mines and the mills, that the easiest way to lower the unit cost of labor was to bring the husband and the wife into the labor force. You double the size of the labor force, you cut the unit value of the labor in half. But you couldn't do that as long as they were worried about their kids. So now you have the impetus to enlarge the social work industry, to corrupt the legislatures, to give it the power to break families apart. And what do you do with the kids? Well, the expression put up for adoption tells you, you don't want them anywhere in the neighborhood. You want them far away. So you put them in boxcars. This great secret, monstrous event in American history that goes on for 40, 50 years. Boxcars full of the children of the labor sent west. They started upstate New York. That was too close. So they kept going farther and farther west. And then they'd stop at a whistle stop. And a platform would be brought out. The boxcar would open. The children would be put up for adoption. They had a preference for who they wanted to adopt. They wanted Lutherans to adopt because they had the Episcopal idea of hierarchy, but they were just dumb farmers. They couldn't think clearly. Here was free labor. Hey, and that will end the future career of these immigrants. What stopped putting children up for adoption was the police chiefs of the West. I think the year was 1888, but give me a few years either way. They wrote a stinging attack on this practice, not on moral grounds, but they said crime is everywhere in the West. And if you go to the psychological abstracts, you'll find that an enormous number of adopted children, for example, 6 of the 10 leading mass murderers in American history, but all forms of crime, because when you break the bond with the natural, you can't put substitutes in place. Again, not morally. There's a recent physiological theory called mirror neurons that you learn to use your own biological equipment by watching people who have the same or nearly identical biological. When you remove that, even if the family that you're transferred to has money and savoir faire and civil, they're more civil, doesn't matter. You're actually imitating things that your physiology can't accommodate. As a consequence, you get incrementally more and more crazed inside and angry. One of the things, of course, school does is it prevents these kind of connections between different areas from occurring. That's what the short answer test is about. And Oxford and Cambridge got rid of it 100 years ago, because they said people who do well on short answer tests, they memorize bits of information, but they don't connect the bits of information. And when they seem to be able to connect the bits of information, it's because they've memorized someone else's connections. The better the school, the more sets of connections you memorize. But you can't do that for yourself. You know, it's like these machines, where you guys are all too young to remember. They used to sell machines that would relieve the stress of lifting weights. You'd put the weight in your hand, but the machine would lift your arm in the way. Only trouble was your muscle knew the difference. But the people buying the machinery didn't. Well, it looks exactly the same. Anyway, put me back on course here.
Is there any connection between frustration and aggression? And what effect does schooling have on that?
Well, you answer your own question by asking it. I mean, the connection's intimate. School removes your volition in all important ways. Even who you speak to are not the arts of association as valuable or more valuable than anything else you learn when you're young. I read how executive hiring is done, and it almost never has to do with your training in whatever you're being hired for. I'm thinking of Apple now, I believe. Is this the person we would like to have around 3 years from now? And bend an elbow with, or play golf with, or just talk with. I mean, and that's why you're passed from set of executives to set of executives, so they can sign off, yeah, he's okay, you know, we can. But we don't tell kids that, right? It's people who have the highest grade point average and the highest SAT scores. Well, I spent an hour years, well, not too long ago, within 10 years, with the admissions officer for Harvard College, and about 30 years ago, an hour with the admissions director at Princeton. And let me tell you, their polite dismissal of grades and SAT scores was intimidating to listen to, as if You'd have to be crazy to let somebody in. Let me see if I can condense how you get into Harvard or Princeton. Of course, you get into both by donating a building, but how do other people get in? They're being analyzed on the basis of their ability to either become wealthy or famous. Either one will work. Famous, like wearing a billboard saying I went to Princeton. There's that actress Jodie Foster, I went to Princeton. Look at where the rest of the actors and directors went. They didn't go anywhere, but Jodie did. So that's the one we hear about. It's the Harvard lady said, we look for a record of excellence. And what does excellence consist of? It's sometime in the first 18 years of your life, figuring out how to add value to the people around you. Although she didn't say this, in a way that catches public attention. So you might walk across the United States or bicycle the perimeter of the country or row across the Atlantic Ocean as a physical way. You might start a little charity or set up some weather service or some pollution monitoring around Hartford. There are a substantial number, a small fraction, but a substantial number of kids doing this as we sit here. They're writing a record of being able to add value to the community around them. And then the other fellow, the Princeton guy, said the same thing in different words. I asked him, what, this about 68 roughly, I asked him, what part of a resume submitted do you look at first? And when the answer metaphorically caused my jaw to open, hobbies, he said. I said, I've been taught all my life, leave that off because it's not germane. He said, on the contrary, it's the only honest information you're likely to get. How does someone spend their time when it's their free choice to spend? He said, it's a window into their mind and their heart. What kind of hobbies? He said, well, ideally someone would have a physical hobby, an intellectual hobby, and a social hobby, because that would show they're exploring these large, well, physical hobby. You mean football, baseball? Well, he said, it's better than nothing, but we would prefer not to see teams. As I've been told all my life, the team sports identify your ability to work in a team. He said, what happens in a team sport is if you decide to dog it, it's very hard to tell which guy on the line has dogged it or not, or which running back has gone down quicker than he should have gone down there. He said, we prefer solo hobbies that involve physical danger. You mean you want kids to put their necks at risk? For example, what? I said. He said, well, horseback riding is a dead giveaway. The horse weighs a half a ton or more. If you do trail riding, you don't know what you're doing. Your head gets caught on a branch and you're the headless horseman. If the horse doesn't like you, it'll roll over on top of you. And I know immediately, because that last time I rode a horse was down in Veracruz, Mexico. The horse didn't like me. Took me out on the main highway with crazed Mexican drivers going 100 miles an hour and 18-wheelers. And it laid down on top of me. I was terrified because I could see these trucks coming. Didn't like that was the last time I rode. So he said, you have to actually know what you're doing. You can't say, is this an A job or a B job if you live and are intact at it. Then he said, sailing a small boat, these little 12-footers, outside of land. If you don't know what you're doing, you end up in the middle of the Atlantic, or if wind comes up, you can't see landmarks because of the waves. I said, but those things are associated with the prosperous classes. What could somebody in ordinary circumstances do? He said, well, we just let somebody in. This is probably one of the nicest factoids in my mind, in my life. We just let someone in who invented his own sport and kept records competing against himself, his past performance, his present performance. It was, get ready for this, visualize this, seatless unicycle riding over broken terrain. If I had 10 lifetimes, the thought of doing that wouldn't occur. Started getting on a unicycle, let alone one without a seat, let alone riding it over broken terrain. So they let him in because they knew he was on the fast track. So we tell these lies, and of course many of the people who tell the lies believe the lies. Well, surely they're going to take valedictorians. Well, last year Harvard turned down 8 out of every 10 valedictorians who applied, and the 2 they took in, they didn't take in because they were valedictorians there. So by removing this component from the student imagination, you can control to some extent who even applies to Harvard and then who gets in, who applies, because they don't know what they're doing. What's the IT garbage in, garbage out? So what I would do was I would examine. I have a friend who started a tutoring service called the Princeton Review, and oh, 20 years ago, they were charging $300 an hour. I have no idea what they charge now. But what they did was crack the code of the questions on standardized tests. And Adam Robinson was his name. Adam took his money and left the Princeton Review to his partner. But Adam has written a book well worth, I think, your group looking up, called What Smart Students Know, Random House, What Smart Students Know. Adam was certain that you could pass standardized tests without having any knowledge of the subject, as long as you understood the constraints, the test, the question architects were under. For example, 2 of the 4 answers offered are always so absurd that if you know that, now you're left with a 50-50 guess. I had figured out when I was in high school that if you had some way to measure the angles on the little geometric figures on the test, that you didn't need to know. You could arrive at the answer simply by, a simplistic means. The evidence that all of us know standardized tests don't measure what they claim to measure is that nobody, I mean nobody you encounter on the upper reaches of society would dream of hiring somebody on the basis of those tests or in grade point averages. You'd be playing Russian roulette because they measure nothing. The grades largely measure that you memorize what you're told to memorize. I mean, there are a few other things, but that's the heart of it. So now you know you have somebody obedient, and probably for a clerk, That is a good measure, not for someone who has to adapt to changing circumstances, you know, by the natural selection process of reality. It's fairly easy without being a wise guy or very learned, as long as you retain the ability to think independently from the data in front of you, to penetrate the masks, the contentions that don't conform to everyday reality. So no one will hire you as a CEO and ask you what you're saying. But if you examine the data that's available about big-time politicians. Now, we have, and I don't think it surprised anybody, that George Bush, the most recent one, was a C average in high school, prep school, and a C average at Yale. What does surprise people is that the candidate he ran against was a C average in prep school, and a C average at Yale, and a lower C average than George Bush's, I was a Kerry of Massachusetts. The fact that the best evidence that the nation has been schooled to the point of extinction is that they were fraternity brothers at Yale in a fraternity, I'll skip its interesting reputation. It only has 15 members. And they were fraternity brothers at Yale. There's 308 million of us. I mean, mathematically, I wouldn't know how to set the odds, but they would be stupendous. No one mentioned it, or if they did, it was to quickly get over that. That should have been headlines with the New York Times and the Washington Post. Fraternity brothers at Yale run for president. You wouldn't need to mention that it was the Skull and Bones fraternity. So when the skew from sanity is that of that magnitude, you should not expect much to come from the watchdogs of our liberty and our best interests. How could that happen unless, but there's a Jewish expression, chutzpah, unless this feeling of contempt for ordinary people was very dramatic. I'm sure someone in the council who allowed that to happen said, maybe someone will notice. To dismiss that shows you how powerless. To believe, for example, another example, that the recent banking crisis, you know, the real estate bubble, is an oddity in American banking. There have been five such since 1961, savings and loan, technology, bubble. There have been five of those, and the central figure in all five is the Citibank of New York. Now, sometimes it's called First National. That's back in 61. Then it becomes Citibank. Then it merges with another huge and it becomes Citigroup. But the mentality loose on that level shows utter contempt for the safeguards built into, you know, the founding documents, or built into tradition as ordinary people, and that includes upper middle class ordinary people, expect it to be. It doesn't exist. Now, what we've run into is a people infinitely more sophisticated than us, with a 5,000-year civilization, who are even more amoral than we are, and look at starving 3 million people to death as they did 20 years ago, is there any shortage of people? I mean, they're already running circles. I've spoken in China half a dozen times for various groups. And the Chinese government is a little bit worried, not a lot, that their system of schooling, very like ours, except more disciplined, it seems to constrain the inventive imagination. The reason they're not worried is they don't recognize copyright law or patent law, so they have access to anything there. But they will not accept, they keep asking me back, they will not accept that the system they're applying to the young mind is guaranteed to foreclose the imagination that produces invention. So I'm happy to take their money and get a chance to see Xi'an and Shanghai and Beijing, but they will follow the course we follow. It'll just take a little bit longer, that's all. Your turn.
In China, they have the outcome-based education system, but they're seeking to tweak it so that they can kind of improve it. They said that we want to keep our people under control, but we want them to be more creative and productive and efficient and happy while they're doing it, right? Now, the question is, if America has become more incoherent, wouldn't that be a function of the Prussian education system, outcome-based education, being used to control the workers and make more profits, and now it's just run its course?
It's run its course. We're exhausted now. Our schooling is exhausted, and the national vitality's been exhausted. I'm glad you used the term incoherence. About 3 or 4 years ago, the Financial Times of London, on the editorial page, accused us of being you may have read the same piece I did, an incoherent society, that we had lost a reason to be a nation at all, because subsidizing bankers and drug companies wasn't a sufficient reason to proceed in history. Yeah, we're incoherent. We don't, nation comes from the root, family. And we no longer have a concern other than a rhetorical concern with one another. I mean, obviously there are many individual exceptions to that, but the government clearly has no such concern. We have evolved an economy that depends upon constant warfare. And even though it was stretching it in Iraq and Afghanistan, when those are over, we must have another conflict. We're going to have to stretch it even further. And maybe attack small islands, Fiji maybe, because they represent a menace. Being a child of World War II, the idea of calling something a war where the enemy has no army, navy, air force, intelligence service, where they blow up their feet in their underwear, it just stretches the bounds of the ridiculous to call it a war. But we got an object lesson from a television comedian who said, when you fly planes into a building, it certainly shows you have courage. And that was temporarily the end of his career. You do not speak in opposition to the main forced driving events. To look at America between, let me roughly say, 1800 and 1865. And then from momentum right up to the First World War, there's this explosion of invention, and it comes from the unlikeliest places. It does not come from university-trained inventors. It comes from everywhere. It's the way people saw the world around them. They saw this world, the elements, the raw material. They processed it a slightly different way, and then they had the expanse, the rhetorical capacity to say, hey, look, there's a better way to do this. It was happening so frequently that a crisis occurred in capitalism. And without understanding this crisis, you really can't understand why our schools are the product of the Rockefeller family, the Carnegie family, the Astor family, the Vanderbilt family, the great capitalist families. They understood that the real problem in successful capitalism is assembling capital, getting people to give you their savings on the promise that you'll give them more back. But if you have people in an inventive matrix who can look at the way the expensive business is doing things, open up across the street and either do it cheaper or better, or simply open up somewhere else where no one is doing it, capital is always at great risk. So, oddly enough, I don't want to claim credit for what really is a brilliant insight, but I want to crave credit. It was openly discussed, let me say, from 1880 to 1900. We were being forcibly converted from an economy of small farmers, small engineers, entrepreneurs, into a corporate economy. And these men doing it, they weren't intellectual dumbcoffs. They could see that as long as the American inventiveness was loose like a wild beast, they were going to have a lot of trouble pulling characters. Someone would say, but I saw, you know, Jack, and he went belly up. So Prussian schooling, which had, for a different reason, had been out to destroy the imagination. And let me say to anyone listening to this, when someone makes a reckless statement like that, you make sure they can document it. And I will document it as long as you're willing to walk to your local public library. Because in every public library worth its salt in the United States and in every college library, you will find a collection of essays by a Prussian philosopher, Johann Fichte, who was the immediate heir to the University of Berlin's philosophy department, which had been under Immanuel Kant. Fichte wrote a series of, it was over a dozen public essays to the Prussian king from, let me say 1808 to about 1818. They're called Addresses to the German Nation. And the provocative event that set the first one off was the Prussian army, which was the Prussian economy, renting soldiers, stealing other people's stuff, had been whipped by Napoleon's amateur army at the Battle of Jena in 1806. And Fichte said it was because this demon imagination was loose among ordinary soldiers, and in situations they would override the orders from headquarters about what to do, and that's why we lost. Now, what should fascinate anyone listening is that's exactly what the so-called liberal philosopher Spinoza in Holland had said in 1690 in a book called Tractatus Politico Religico-Politicus, Tractatus Religico-Politicus. Spinoza said that the ordinary population was so psychologically diseased, murderously so, there was no way to heal it. Just as Fichte, 125 years later, said there was no way to heal the disobedience gene in people who thought for themselves. Fichte said we have to set up a system of forced schooling, universal forced schooling, in which we destroy the imagination. Bells, ordered lessons, constant testing, rankings. Now, if it were only those two major figures, but you now can go back a few hundred years in history to John Calvin's Institutes of the Christian Religion, which is this thick, tiny print. But if you ever go mad and actually force yourself to read it, rather than to read what an encyclopedia tells you it says, you'll find that Calvin says that the saved are saved before they're born. The damned, who are 19 to 1, are damned before they're born, and no amount of good work or behavior can save the damned, and no amount of evil behavior can damn the saved. The expression that used to be pretty common, but has vanished, I think on purpose, is justified sinners. The saved are justified sinners who can do anything. They can carpet bomb civilian populations, whether they're Nazis or Americans. You know, you've done no harm, according to Calvin. Calvin said the only way the elect, he called the saved, the elect will be ever be safe because they're outnumbered so heavily, is to set up a system of universal compulsion schooling with the intention of destroying the imagination and filling the head with garbage. Spinoza said the same thing. Fichte said the same thing.
So I think we just ran out of tape. Is that what happened? Is that one still running?
Yes, it's
but it has no micro. Yeah. All right. So we're going to take a 10-minute break.
Oh, good.
We're going to change the tapes. We're going to turn all these lights out. We're going to turn the AC back on and cool you off. If you want to get up and move around, use the bathroom.